My name is Penny Dreadful. My journey is beginning. A journey that I hope will open the doors of life to me and link my past with my future. A journey that will bring me to a strange and dark place, to the edge of the sea, high atop Widow's Hill. And there, I am sure to find terror at Collinwood. Welcome to episode 2 of Terror at Collinwood. This is Penny Dreadful, and I have a spectral guest here with me this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Eric Marshall, my good friend. Eric and I have known each other for several years now, and we've been co-writers on the Masters of the Universe brand on the Toy Bios, and we've worked together on the Dark Horse books, several Masters of the Universe Dark Horse books, which we've been both fortunate enough to work on. Eric is an extremely talented writer. He is an artist. He is a graphic designer, and he designed the logo for this podcast that you're listening to right now. I love that logo, the woodcut design. Eric, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining me today.
Good evening.
Crossover, Barnabas meets Alfred Hitchcock. I love this.
Well, my favorite line so far of the show is, "I should know."
Well, Eric, tell us a little bit about your history in terms of your viewing history when it comes to Dark Shadows.
So I've seen it scattered throughout the years, and I know I've seen it I know I was not in school anymore, but I do have the back of my mind coming home and seeing episodes for several weeks, you know, at a time before something happened and I couldn't, I started missing it. I think maybe when it was on Sci-Fi Channel or something like that, where they were, you know, definitely editing it down. So you weren't getting, you knew you were missing things because they were cutting a few seconds off for commercials. And I remembered, primarily I remembered that it was a lot of, I didn't know at first that it was live. So I remember a lot of talking about things. I remember Quentin and Barnabas were both heavily mentioned, but they never seemed to meet each other. They, you know, like you're, I felt like I was being hyped for these two characters to run into one another. Mm-hmm. And I remember specifically thinking Quentin was supposed to turn into a werewolf, and it never happened. Mm-hmm. At least not in the episodes I saw. And I didn't realize, well, of course it wouldn't. It's live TV. They weren't going to easily, I mean, I guess they could have, because I haven't gotten Quentin yet in my current viewing. I guess they could always do like they did with Jeremiah's ghost and just have somebody else come in.
That's exactly what they did. They had Alex Stevens, who was a stuntman, and he played the werewolf in the show. So when Quentin transformed, they would, fade to they'd do a fade transformation where it would, you know, fade from one actor to the other. That's how they accomplished the werewolf transformation. So they actually used a different actor to play. There are two werewolf characters on the show. There's one other besides Quentin, but Alex Stevens played the wolf form for both of those characters. Yeah.
Well, and I didn't, I know there were more werewolves, and I know I did not realize early on that they do time travel so much.
Yes.
Because I was aware, I was like, so the show is a period piece. And then this isn't a period piece. Did they travel forward in time or something? And did not realizing it started in modern 1967. And that the jumping around in time was really one of the more fantastical and unique aspects of the show. Mm-hmm. Unique in that you didn't normally, I guess, do that with vampires. You might have flashbacks, but not actually travel.
Right. Yeah, definitely.
And then somehow prevent the character who does the time traveling from realizing she's talking to the vampire as a human. Which I keep forgetting. Oh, that's right. She's not going to know that this is the same Barnabas because she doesn't know he's a vampire.
Right. She thinks he's his ancestor. And that's where you are in you've gone back to Tubi now, and you've watched the series from the beginning. Yeah. And you're in 1795 right now, right?
Right. She's just, Vicky has just been captured by Reverend Trask. That's the mm-hmm. where I'm at. And I had never seen it from the beginning when you told me that And I know I had tried to watch it, and I could tell that it wasn't the beginning. Mm-hmm. And that's when you told me that it's because they broke it up. And the first 200 episodes are Dark Shadows, the beginning, which is also on Tubi. And so that opened everything up, because I really liked seeing from the beginning and getting the setting, because I know when I had been younger and seen the scatterings of episodes, I never quite figured out what's with the sea. Why do we keep seeing the waves on the rocks? And exactly what's the house to everybody? Because it wasn't always obvious to me that they were in that house, especially since there are two houses. I didn't understand the setting and the atmosphere, because in the episodes I remember seeing, they weren't exactly stopping to tell you very much about Collinwood's history or, you know, Collinsport's history. Mm-hmm. So the context wasn't really there. Mm-hmm. And so I really liked being able to see the original episodes and see, oh, this is the world they've gotten into. I mean, you don't absolutely need it to enjoy some of the crazy stuff going on. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Those episodes were, they did not air those in syndication when they syndicated the show in the 70s. It always started with Barnabas. Ooh. And those episodes remained unseen until MPI Home Video released them and the Sci-Fi Channel started playing Dark Shadows. When that happened, then people finally got to watch those episodes in the 90s. So for 25 years or so, you know, those episodes were unseen. And you made an interesting point when we emailed each other, which I agree with. And it never really occurred to me, but you know, we've had several attempts to reboot Dark Shadows or to remake Dark Shadows. We had the 91 series. There's the unaired 2004 pilot. And then I heard there was something in 2012. I don't remember exactly what it was, but it was some, I don't know, something that rhymes with Hurton, Jim Hurton. I don't know. They always start
with Snark Shadows. Is what that
yeah, Snark Shadows. the movie that shall not be named here. But they always start with Barnabas every time, including the 91 series, which Dan Curtis helmed, always starts with Barnabas. And you made an interesting point in the email that you sent to me, which was that maybe they shouldn't start with Barnabas. Maybe they should devote, you know, a couple of weeks at least to developing, bringing in Burke Devlin and Victoria Winters and establishing the Collins family and the Collins family history and Collinsport, and maybe having hints of Barnabas. You see his portrait in the background and they mention him and things, but not diving into Barnabas right in the first episode, you know, maybe building up to that if they were to attempt another remake. And I think that would be an interesting approach, because it would really set the stage for Barnabas.
Yeah, I really did find it interesting how Burke Devlin was kind of, you might want to talk about it more later, but mm-hmm. Burke Devlin was sort of the Barnabas of the first 200 episodes. He was mm-hmm. the mysterious character, except they all knew who he was and we didn't. They all knew how he was dangerous, but we were trying to figure that out. Whereas with Barnabas, we knew this guy's dangerous. We knew his, we could pretty much tell he was a vampire. We weren't, you know, it was confirmed after a couple of episodes, because I guess you could maybe have not known it. I think it was pretty clear, but they were sly enough that maybe that first episode you could just be a little confused. But we knew it, and the characters had no idea. So that really changed. By that point, we knew the characters, so that wasn't a problem. But I think that was part of what turned me off about the remakes, was that you don't know who these people are yet, and now they're reacting to another character you don't know yet, which is Barnabas. And it was like you haven't really gotten to know anybody yet. You haven't really formed a bond with anybody yet. Mm. I guess maybe the movie figured, who cares,
Right. You mean the House of Dark Shadows, the first one, or the Burton?
I would like to see that one. All I know is that Carolyn dies, and that makes me mad.
Yeah, House of Dark Shadows is grim. It's the Barnabas story, you know, but, you know, minus it's
Dracula, right?
it's Barnabas is much more evil. Yeah, there's no Sarah. There's no the shred of conscience is, you know, maybe it's maybe a much smaller shred, maybe. You know, but yeah, no, it's very I really like it. It's very much a horror movie in the sort of style of say a Hammer film, you know. And I mean the show is, you know, it's gothic horror in the show too, but Barnabas is more multifaceted in the show, especially as it goes along and you know the character develops throughout the series, whereas House of Dark Shadows is Barnabas is a monster, you know, through and through. There's no redemption there for Barnabas, you know, but I enjoyed the movie. I like it. Some fans dislike it. Some fans love it. But I really enjoyed it. But today we're going to actually not talk as much. Well, of course, we're going to talk about Barnabas for sure, but not, but we're going to focus in today's episode on the first part of the pre-Barnabas storyline. You know, we could break the pre-Barnabas storyline into two halves. Is there's the first half, and then there's the Laura the Phoenix half of the pre-Barnabas storyline. This part of it, though, focuses on the arrival of Victoria Winters and the search for her parentage, the revenge of Burke Devlin, and the death of Bill Malloy, which is, I suppose, is tied into the Burke Devlin storyline as well. That's, you know, kind of connected to that. And the whole premise for Dark Shadows when it started was, you know, Dan famously, you know, Dan Curtis had this dream. You know, he had a dream one night where a dark-haired young woman was on a train heading to a remote New England town to serve as a governess at this large brooding mansion overlooking the ocean. And that was the dream he had. So he became obsessed with this dream and pitched it to, met with an ABC executive, and he pitched the show as a nighttime series, a suspense series at night. And they wanted to do it as a daytime series instead. Curtis just, you know, he agreed to it. And so they promoted the show as daytime television's first ongoing suspense series. And the commercials, you know, it was an Orson Welles-esque announcer, you know, talking about the terror at Collins' house. And Curtis got Art Wallace involved, writer. He wanted him to produce the show initially, but Wallace declined and suggested that Robert Costello produce the show. Art Wallace wrote the series Bible and wrote about the first maybe, I don't know, 60 to 80 episodes in that range, him and Francis Swan, I believe. And that story Bible was called Shadows on the Wall. That was one of the proposed titles for the series, as well as actually Curtis suggested Terror at Collinwood, which is the name of this podcast. That's where that came from. And in that story Bible, you get a lot of what we did see in that pre-Barnabas storyline. Of course, it went in different directions in the story Bible, et cetera. But essentially, you get Wallace used as the basis for Dark Shadows. There was an anthology series in the 50s and called Television Playhouse. That's what it was in 1957. He wrote an episode of that anthology series called The House. And in that story, there is a woman who lives in a, you know, house on an estate in a New England town, and her husband disappeared. He's a fisherman, a seaman, disappeared mysteriously, and she's living in this remote house. And part of that initial storyline came from that. And then part of it was, of course, it was Jane Eyre, Charlotte Bronte, you know, the young governess coming to this brooding mansion. And they will revisit Jane Eyre several times in the series, especially during the 1897. You'll see some direct, you know, lifts from Jane Eyre there. And then, of course, Burke Devlin is the Count of Monte Cristo. This man was wrongfully imprisoned. And when he leaves, he amasses a fortune and attempts to get his revenge. And so they have, in effect, I think Burke is even reading the Count of Monte Cristo in one scene in those episodes. And then there's also a film called The Uninvited, which was released in 1944. It was a horror movie about a brother and sister who buy this an old mansion on a cliff overlooking the ocean, and the mansion is haunted by this sad the spirit of this woman, the sad spirit. She died, you know, going over the cliff. So they're pulling from these sort of existing story. I mean, the Dark Shadows, did this all through its run. They put classic gothic horror stories on the shelf here and gothic romance and kind of pull some stuff from. But these, of course, are archetypal ideas that they sort of worked in terms of the gothic, right? So
yeah.
We went into this and our initial storyline we went in is, well, let's start with Victoria Winters here. So she is our protagonist in the show, Victoria Winters, played by Alexandra Moltke. And she's searching for her parentage. She's trying to find out. She's in the Hammond Foundling home. She's been receiving $50 a month when she doesn't know who it's from Bangor, Maine. From Bangor, Maine, she's getting this $50 a month. So she's connecting it to Collinwood. So she comes to this house, and when she's on the train at the train station, she meets this other stranger, Burke Devlin, who's also, you know, you don't know much about Burke, like you pointed out. So what was your initial sort of reaction to this sort of situation here with Victoria Winters?
Well, I definitely saw the gothic quality of the story, and what really struck to me the most was I had just been reading Shirley Jackson's The House, the Haunted Hill House.
Yes. Yeah,
and particularly the scene where she's talking to the waitress. Mm-hmm. So then when we had the scene with Maggie, that really, I think it was something about how mundane it all seemed, yet you knew something really sinister and powerful was ahead of this girl. That's about in the case of at this point, I suppose, in the case of Vicky, it's nothing as supernatural as yet. It's just secrets, but she wants to find out about her home and her origin. And I think that mystery was immediately enticing, and you knew that there had to be an answer to it, which I feel is probably not getting closer the further I get into the show.
I have some bad news for you, Eric.
I really have to say it's interesting. As I've watched more of the show, I didn't realize how unique some things were. Like Maggie is completely different in her first appearance. It's not even all just the wig they put her in. She's more like Sam. She sounds weird, world weary, like Sam, her father, mm-hmm. later does.
Yeah, they wanted her to be a young Eve Arden, and in her first, you know, when they hired her. But you know, Catherine Lee Scott, she's fantastic. She's a fantastic actress. But I think her genuine kind of sweetness was coming through, and so I think they probably told her, well, let's go in that direction with the character instead, you know.
I thought it was actually a nice contrast that she had a world. She did feel world weary. She felt credible as this somebody who, I mean, it's just ironic that Victoria has come from New York, and here this girl in this small town, it sounds like she's the one who's been out and seen the world.
Victoria
sounds like the little girl that's, you know, I just came to the big house to work, you know.
Sure. And Maggie kind of serves also as the sort of the voice of Collinsport in a way too, like stay away from that house, you know. There she tells her not to go to the house, and that she'd see things that'll send her all the way back to New York and all this. Yeah.
But she couldn't help but comfort her at the end. She asked, are you, you know, or Vicky asked, did you really mean all that stuff? And she goes, no, honey, I was just, having a fit. You'll have a good time. You
know? Right.
I mean, I thought that kind of worked. Maybe they had something richer in mind, but, she did have a girl. She became the girl next door as they went along. But I actually liked the edgier Maggie enough that I missed her once it became clear that they were going to. I think probably I got a little angry with Sam. I thought he was a bit. I don't know quite what it is about him, but I just thought it was funny when we did finally get into the 1795 storyline. The actor finally felt at home with the way he wanted to deliver his lines.
Yeah.
He always sounded really rich for the character of this, you know, drunken artist.
Right, right. And he played David Ford played John Hancock actually in 1776 in the musical. Yeah, yeah. So he definitely has that very rich voice. Absolutely. So definitely. He also did have a difficult time with his lines as an actor.
Oh,
it's, I mean, with a daily show, like, I mean, it was difficult for, okay. I think, and he had a tough time with the teleprompter to the point where I don't want to spoil anything for you, but there's an incident will take place that they'll try to kind of bring in to help cover the fact that he's reading from the teleprompter, but it doesn't really help. But I love Sam, but he's definitely, you know, Sam Evans is very troubled, you know, when we come into the series. And it's funny because if you go into the series, as most people did in the syndicated episodes, and even when it was very popular in the 60s, a lot of people kind of jumped in post Barnabas. Sam was a very different character too, because prior to revealing that he witnessed the accident that led to Burke going to prison and being framed for what Roger did. Sam was paid off by Roger to not speak of that. So Sam is a very tormented character in those episodes. Yeah.
It wasn't, I think, just that he, I mean, I did struggle with this because I felt like the answers were felt a little bit mundane for how much drama some of the things had gone through. I guess because I'm thinking, okay, Burke Devlin spent 5 years in jail and now he's been out for five more and he's rich. I mean, can you really drink yourself into a stupor over how wronged? But the thing is that he knew Burke as a boy, or at least he had, I think you're supposed to feel, it was maybe a little awkward where he's saying, I used to pose for his model for him as a boy. And it's like, what was going on? You know, I mean, just that relationship seems odd, you know, but I think you're supposed to see it because it was a more innocent time. That this was like a surrogate son to him.
Oh yeah, yeah, and that's definitely yeah.
And he betrayed him. Yeah, and I think I was. I don't want to jump ahead to Laura, but everything about that accident was so crucial to everything that happened for the first 200 episodes. Really, I mean, it informed just about every storyline.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, it never seemed like we went through like, what was it, two episodes where they forced Sam to tell Vicky and Maggie forced him to tell them what had happened.
Mm-hmm.
And it ends up being like, still leaves a lot of questions for me. Like I didn't quite pick up on what Laura was doing there. Was she trying to get Roger to notice her and Burke was trying to get her to notice him? Were they fighting over Laura? In which case, how was marrying Roger paying her off exactly? I mean, there was a lot about that we never really got because we never really met the real Laura.
Right, right.
And we never really got to, you know, we never got to find out exactly what, for such an important event, I guess, it felt like it never decided about certain things.
It's definitely mentioned, you know, that Laura was, her personality completely changed when she came back. And of course we know she's reborn in,
right,
you know, in the flames, but we get the sense that she's a very kind of unstable person and very, I could see her kind of playing them against each other, even in the way, based on the way they described her personality prior to that, you know, and drinking and kind of partying and that sort of thing. So I don't know. We never see Laura. We never see what Laura was like,
right,
prior to her rebirth, you know?
Well, I think they kind of avoided making any of the characters too naughty. If that, I mean, like what you and I have said, it's like, okay, clearly Vicky has to be Elizabeth's daughter. You know, I mean,
right.
And I don't know how, because she couldn't have been born in wedlock. She must, maybe she was the child of rape. You know, there was some kind of dark story there they did not choose to tell. And I'm pretty sure David is Burke's son.
Well, they definitely hint at that pretty strongly. Yeah. I'm going to go against that because I think he is definitely is Roger's son, because I'm basing that. Well, I mean, you had a theory.
Oh, I believe Burke is a Collins.
That Burke, yeah, your theory is that Burke is a Collins, which is really interesting too. Explain your thoughts on that. I'm curious, because that's a new one for me, because Vicky, yeah, I mean, there's Vicky has to be a Collins originally in the pilot or in the story Bible. She was going to be, they were going to reveal that she was Paul Stoddard's daughter. And they did hint at the B. Hanscom. Remember the Betty Hanscom, the portrait of Betty Hanscom that looked just like Vicky. And she soon turned out she was the daughter of the butler Hanscom, which they also hint, talk about him when, yes, when she goes to the Garner's office. He's like, oh, there was a butler named Hanscom.
Yeah.
Right. That's and the idea was going to be that Paul Stoddard had an affair with Betty Hanscom, and that Victoria was born from that affair. And that after Elizabeth thought she killed Paul, that she was felt so much guilt. She found out about Victoria that same night that she felt obligated to take care of her. And of course, as the show went on, when after they cast Alexandra Moltke, they noticed she bore some resemblance to Joan Bennett, with the, particularly with the dark hair, you know, and the fair skin. And they said, they started thinking along the lines of, oh, she's Elizabeth's daughter. So they were thinking about, I think Ron Sproat was going to start bringing that back in and kind of try to resolve that, but they never did. There are these audio dramas with Big Finish, and one of them, the thing that kicked that off was Return to Collinwood, which was written by David Selby's son, Jameson Selby, and in that it is revealed that Victoria is Elizabeth's daughter. Now, I personally don't consider those 100% canon. I mean, they're official. They're officially licensed, you know, stories. I think of them in the same way that I think of like House and Night of Dark Shadows or the Marilyn Ross novelizations. You know, they're sort of a parallel time version, but regardless, Vicky has to be the daughter. I think most people kind of feel the same way, that she needs to be Liz's daughter. But what about Burke? Like why do you feel Burke is a Collins?
So I'm trying to remember what got me started thinking that. I think I felt that the drama about just how much he really hated the Collinses, there was something about that felt like he was rejected by them. And I'm sure he was, but somehow like it was a deeper rivalry. I don't think he would have known that he is a Collins, though. It would have been like, most thing that makes the most sense would be he's some sort of cousin. Mm-hmm. But then I don't know that they had any cousins. You know, the Collinses are have a fairly small brood ultimately in 1960s. I mean, that's the thing that gets lost, I think, in the later episodes, is that Collinsport is kind of on its way out. It's like a ghost town.
Right.
They never stop the trains there. The one lady's telling Vicky, you know, no one comes here, you know, they're stopping just for you and this one other guy, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that sense that that this was something that was on decline was just something that kind of got slowly bled out of it. You know, just it became less important. It's not so much that it they forgot about it, as they just had other stuff they were doing.
Sure, yeah, and in the true Gothic sense, you know, the town itself is a metaphor, you know, for the Collins family themselves. There, that decline, that sort of the fall of the House of Usher, you know, feeling where there's, you know, it's kind of waning and dying out, just as the town itself is, you know, as a reflection of the Collins family. Sure.
Carolyn introduced, that was her first line to Vicky, is welcome to the House of Usher.
Yes, definitely. It actually, in a couple of those early episodes, they reference the fall of the House of Usher, and they reference Dracula too. In those early episodes. Now, you bring up Carolyn. I know she's one of your favorite characters. So what is it about Carolyn that you really like?
I should just say about Burke. I think also the tradition of the returning heir that was wrongfully kind of the Isaac and Ishmael kind of thing. You know, I want what's properly mine. I've been cheated and out of something that should be mine. And he wanted Collins wood itself too.
Yes, yes.
Which is something they forgot later. Yeah. Or I shouldn't say forget. They gave that up.
Well, yeah. Burke kind of let go of that. When he fell in love with Vicky, I think they softened the character, like that desire for revenge, kind of that boiling sort of anger sort of subsided, you know, and he respected Elizabeth. I mean, you could tell even
he did.
You know, despite his feelings about Roger, he respected Elizabeth, and that grows as he becomes closer to Vicky as well.
Right. I think he liked all of them. That was the thing. Mm-hmm. He only had a problem with Roger. Yeah. So it was like, you know, he kept talking about taking down the Collinses, but that was just, it's like, you don't really want to take down the Collins. You want to take down Roger.
Roger. Yeah.
And even in the first episode, that was Elizabeth said to Roger, you're the only problem here.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what I think was going on. Yeah. So,
It's kind of shocking, I think, for people too, when they see Roger and David too in those early episodes. I mean, David is proof you don't need the supernatural to have a monster show. David is he's a psychopath. You know, the talk about the disturbed child who's, you know, murderous. You know, he has a murderous streak in those shows. But I want to get to David for sure, and Roger and Elizabeth. But Carolyn, let's talk about Carolyn, because I know she's a favorite of yours.
She really is. I love. I think the actress has a lot of wit to her.
Nancy Barrett. Yeah, she's fantastic.
She brings out, and she's doing it with very, I mean, they did give her a lot of good lines, but I felt like as they went along, they just didn't use her as much. And they weren't, in a way, that was actually hurting the character, because she was so hip. This is somebody who should probably have been away at school and didn't want to become shut in like her mother, and yet somehow couldn't abandon her mother either. So she had a compelling, for me, there was pathos there. There was a gravitas to her. Mm-hmm. And the one thing I think was probably not very likable was that she kind of was immediately smitten by Burke and, you know, and was throwing, I don't blame her. Joe was boring, but, you know, and what's more,
poor Joe.
Poor Joe indeed. When they switched to color, his eyes were so blue. I was like, what the heck? Brown eyes. And dark hair. He was blonde and blue eyed. What happened? The fact that they said that Joe was mommy's choice for Carolyn.
Right.
Why she did not want Joe.
No,
best of worst, you know?
Carolyn is perpetually drawn, and this becomes a recurring character trait for Carolyn. She's drawn to the most dangerous character in the room. She seems to be, it starts with Burke, even though he isn't supernatural, but Carolyn, for some reason, she's like, every time there's a character who comes into the show and there's some type of monster or supernatural being, Carolyn seems to be attracted to them. It became kind of a recurring thing almost in the show. I don't know if they intended to do that or if it just turned out that way. But
I felt like they changed their minds a couple of times. Like, that was her first reaction to Jason McGuire. And then like two episodes later, she's, that man's a rat or something. I was like, what happened here? You know, she finally, I was glad. I didn't want her to be, you know, interested in him. And I was never terribly happy with her being interested in Burke, because again, secretly her uncle or cousin, I'm awkward.
But, if Vicky is a Collins, then that problem is still present. Yeah, but
I wasn't too keen on him being with Vicky either. Really. I don't think I was looking at Burke being anybody's love interest. I guess that's what he'd have to be in the story. But with her interest in Burke, she seemed completely unrealistically oblivious to the fact that he wanted to take out her uncle Roger, who she was devoted to. I thought maybe she would be annoyed with her uncle Roger, but she wasn't. She actually defended him against something Vicky said at one point that was like, oh, you really love him, but you think that Burke is an okay guy to be. Maybe part of it was her thinking she can tame this guy who wants to hurt her family. And, you know, that'll show her power or something. I don't know.
I think Carolyn, I mean, growing up in that house, yeah, is troubled to some extent, you know, there.
Oh, she, yeah. Her story about Randy, the ghost.
Sure. Yeah.
Might have been a ghost. I don't know.
Yeah.
Or the same sweater. I mean, maybe it's just poor. I don't know.
I mean, there's definitely evidence that they've all experienced strange things that they sort of brush under the rug. And in fact, I think Roger at one point even says that very thing to Elizabeth, that, you know, we've seen, you know, as well as I do, you know, that we've both seen things that we can't explain in this house, you know? So I think there, and being in that house and that environment, that sort of oppressive environment, must affect a person. But underneath that, I think there is a very earnest, sincere, and kind-hearted person. And Carolyn, in many ways, in some ways, she does become the sort of the heart of the show. You could argue that with Maggie as well. But, you know, I think especially when you see the 1995 storyline and how what happened to Carolyn is, you know, it's sad, but it's like that's, they picked that character for a reason to get that across to the viewer. And I think, and you see when, you know, when Elizabeth, like I'm jumping ahead to Laura, but when Elizabeth is, you know, placed into that sort of comatose state by Laura, she puts Carolyn in charge of Collinwood and the Collins, you know,
not Roger, Carolyn,
you know, and she chooses Carolyn, you know, for a reason, because she knows what Carolyn is capable of, I think, you know, yeah. So Nancy Barrett is, as you point out, she's a great actress. She'll play some really great roles too in the show, in addition to Carolyn in the show. You're watching her as Millicent right now, and she's fun to watch.
And when she came in as Millicent and she has this high pitched laugh, I was like, oh, the actress, you know, Nancy Barrett is making a real comment on what they're doing.
Yes. Yeah.
I can play the stupid airhead if you want.
Yes.
You
know? The fragile, you know.
Yeah.
But, like a bird almost.
Oh, I was so glad when they didn't, you know, when they made a big thing about she was self-destructive because of the Jason McGuire thing, mostly because she could tell that her mother was not telling her something and she didn't really know how to reach her because her mother, you know, Elizabeth doesn't, if she doesn't want to be reached, she's not going to be reached. Mm-hmm. When it came out that I killed Paul, she was like, she killed my father. And I was like, oh no, they're not going to have her go into like some kind of psycho trance and traumatized about this, are they? I mean, I feel like she's beyond being that, you know, that vulnerable or that fragile. And then immediately the next episode she comes in and she's, you know, she actually says it doesn't matter before she finds out that in fact her mother didn't do, you know, again, they had to make sure that Elizabeth had to be a saint at all times. the times I felt like Elizabeth was made to be a little too saintly for how much she apparently had to do to keep the family afloat. I do think actually a show about young Carolyn or a show about young Roger and Elizabeth would be very interesting to see with all the time travel. I'm sorry.
Oh, absolutely. I often wish they had done a story that was set, you know, in the 30s or something where you see them when they're younger, you know, I think that would have been really sensational if they had done that. Now, speaking of Elizabeth and Roger, let's talk a little bit about them. Elizabeth, of course, played by the Hollywood legend Joan Bennett, which was a huge deal for, you know, a daytime TV show to bring in Joan Bennett as a lead for the series. And it's interesting, you know, it's like if you watch those early episodes, and in addition to having sort of Joan Bennett as your star of your show, there were a lot of exterior shots that they did in those early episodes, which was also unheard of in daytime television back then, like doing, you know, shots of the cliffs and the ocean and going out into the town and showing, you know, the exterior shots of the blue whale and Sam Evans' cottage and Maggie Evans' cottage and the cannery and Roger walking into the cannery and things like that.
Yeah,
like,
oh my gosh.
I missed that stuff when they did go to color. You know, we lost the exterior, you know, filmed footage, and I thought that was really cool to see that. Definitely. So Joan Bennett, of course, as Elizabeth Collins, starred the matriarch of the family. All the characters who live at Collinwood are troubled to some extent. So of course, Elizabeth is, you know, there's a sadness about her at all times. And I thought Joan Bennett was so great at having that presence. You know, she just had that without even saying a line, just her standing there, she conveyed that sort of, you know, a regal sort of quality. And as we go along, you know, we find out what happened with Paul Stoddard, as we talked about, and we find out why she is that way. What did you think of Elizabeth as a character?
I like her. I think I kind of am under the impression that, and I don't know if we ever get to it, I get the impression her parents died when she was young. Both her and Roger were young. Mm-hmm. That's why they might not have been around to discourage Paul Stoddard. I'm not exactly sure. It didn't get mentioned exactly, or if it did, I don't remember.
Their father is Jameson, who we will meet in 1897 as a child, played by David Hennessy. Yeah.
Yeah. I wasn't sure what the circumstances were when she married Paul, if there's been no mention so far of her parents. So I don't, you know, as of say the middle of the 1795 arc, obviously everything's been paused.
Sure. Yeah. You'll hear a little bit more, but it's very little. Like I don't recall them ever talking about their mother. They do mention their father again later, but there isn't a whole lot. You will learn a lot more about Paul Stoddard. There'll be more Paul Stoddard story stuff.
Well, they gave, just like when Burke was finally killed off, they gave him the most soap opera ending. Yeah, his plane went down. We found these bodies unrecognizable. He must be dead.
Sure. Which opens the door to, right. Of course, you know, I mentioned the audio dramas. I sent you the
Yes, thank you. Yes. Yes. I started listening. I heard the, you know, I know you.
Yeah. There's one of the big Finnish audio dramas for, you know, the listeners who may not have heard it, is called And Red All Over. And it's Mitchell Ryan, the first Burke Devlin, the, you know, the one I think everybody, Anthony George, I thought was good as Jeremiah, but I think it was such a big shift when you went from Mitchell Ryan to Anthony George. It was difficult to sort of accept him as Burke, but it's Mitch Ryan returning as Burke Devlin. And the audio drama, canon or not, it gives closure, I think, to the character. It's a really interesting story, and gives more closure to the character than what we got in the show, the off-screen plane crash. So it's an interesting story and well worth checking out if you like the character of Burke Devlin, and has Catherine Lee Scott in it too as Maggie Evans, which is a great pairing for sure for that audio drama.
Yeah, I didn't think I'd like Burke because I was aware he wasn't a vampire or anything supernatural. And again, the more I got about his revenge plot, the less it was like, oh, this isn't fantastical. This is just a car crash. Yeah. But I think what happened was when they resolved that storyline, I think they kind of just decided to discard most of the intrigue about him. Mm-hmm. And he was sort of reduced to now you're Victoria's love interest. And, you know, they found a way to make that useful for the Jeremiah part of it.
Yeah.
But in fairness to Anthony George, he took on the role pretty much right when there was nothing left of Burke's original, I want to get even with the Collinses, or there wasn't even really, I think that he'd had already had a scene where he'd had a couple of scenes with Elizabeth where it was clear that they respected each other.
Yes.
Yep. After he had already kind of expressed a desire to take her out or take her down, you know,
right.
He kind of found himself respecting her. And I think that, gosh, yeah, I said it's really funny how so many of the plots at the beginning of the first 200 episodes, it's all about that, you know, plot of his to get
it back really is. Family. It's and, very focused on that, you and know,
everything, and everything else is a distraction. Bill Malloy's a distraction. The car, Roger's car crash because David disrupted that. That's a distraction.
The bleeder valve. Yeah. Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
The pen is a distraction.
Oh, the pen. Geez. Yeah. Yeah. The pen.
they're all distractions for what isn't even a particularly, you know, complex mystery, you know,
sure.
It's like, I mean, the thing with Jason and Paul was more intricate, I thought. And yet even, and by the time they resolve that one, I kind of think everybody's like, let's get it over with. Because
right. Yeah. That storyline, I mean, it was lasted about two. I mean, they resolved the Burke revenge plot shortly before Barnabas came right. on. I mean, it was right before Barnabas came on. So that went on for over 200 episodes of Burke, the Burke Devlin revenge plot. And it, like you say, it wasn't that complex of a storyline. And of course, I mean, this storyline is, it's indicative of what Dark Shadows, I think, was as when it started out. They were going for this sort of suspense and this revenge plot and the murder mystery with Bill Malloy, and the ratings weren't there for that. And that's when Dan Curtis said, well, let's make it supernatural, you know, and then you see your first...
When that ghost walked out of the painting in episode 70, it's like, whoa.
Right, right. And
we are taking this to a new level.
Yes. And I can only imagine what it must have been like to be a viewer at that time, where you're watching this show and it's, you know, there's the house on the hill and they talk about ghosts, but they use them sort of in a metaphorical way and you don't really see them. And then all of a sudden, I think just prior to that, you saw a book open by itself.
Yeah.
A Collins Family History just opened by itself, which was the first hint of that. And then you saw Josette's, the ghost of Josette, mm-hmm. come out of the portrait and, you know, sort of dance around the columns in this sort of eerie shot at the end of the episode where she's dancing around and the music comes up and then it ends. And it's like, whoa, this is, and every time they did that, the ratings went up a little bit. So they put a ghost in and the ratings went up. And of course, Josette became a fixture in the show. And then that led, as we went on, Bill Malloy, that was kind of tied to the Burke Devlin plot, which, you know, we had Bill Malloy as a character who was very loyal to Elizabeth, and he runs the Collins fishing fleet. And I really like that actor, Frank Schofield, as Bill Malloy, and I kind of wished they had brought him back at least his ghost or parallel time counterpart when they go into parallel time, Bill Malloy would have been kind of cool, but yeah. So Bill Malloy, his murder becomes a sort of a big plot point as well. Who killed Bill Malloy? And I think it's not that as far as murder mysteries go, I don't think, I mean, they try to kind of make it look like Roger did it, but I think it's pretty clear. I don't know if it's just because I had read about the storyline prior to having watched it back in the day, but it seemed pretty clear to me that it was Matthew Morgan, who was first played by George Mitchell and then played by Thayer David.
Yeah, that was a surprising recast because they didn't look anything alike. It was
no.
Like, what happened? I would say that I don't remember if I knew ahead of time or not, but I actually didn't think it was that predictable because Matthew was so devoted to Elizabeth as well. It was like, oh, I didn't realize the murderer was just stupid. You know, he killed the guy that was trying to help her.
Right,
you
know, right.
That totally confused it because you thought the murderer was actually somebody who, you know, maybe Burke hired somebody to get rid of. I mean,
okay. So as somebody who came into it without any prior knowledge about the murder, you didn't know it was Matthew Morgan then?
I didn't. I mean, I suspected Matthew. Well, eventually I read it before I think they finally revealed it. But before that, I didn't believe it would have been him.
Oh, okay.
So
okay.
Clearly, Malloy and Matthew had the same end game.
Okay. So did you think it was Roger?
Well, I figured it couldn't be because it couldn't be Roger because it was so obvious that Roger was guilty. Mm-hmm. Part of you is like, well, that's got to be a red herring, right? And and also I didn't really think they would let a member of the family actually be guilty because there weren't that many members of the family. If there were more members of the family, I might have figured he was more expendable, but there really weren't. So of course I found, you told me that the original plan would have been a dramatic confrontation and he would have been guilty and fallen off Widow's Hill.
Oh, it would have been, he would have tried to push Vicky off Widow's Hill. And he would have tripped, David would have been there and called out, and Vicky would have gotten out of the way as Roger was going to push her, and he would have died. They were going to kill Roger off. But I think Louis Edmonds was such a charming actor, and in real life too, he was very personable guy. I think the character was fun to watch, and they decided to keep him on the show. And they, you know, his character went through some changes as well, as especially I think after his son almost burned alive, you know, and then watching that happen, he sort of, I think they definitely softened the character of Roger. He was still pompous, but he was not.
He showed actual concern for David finally after calling him a monster all the time, which he was actually, but
yeah.
I don't know if, again, trying to retcon it all and say that something to do with the Phoenix force or whatever it was, the Phoenix entity maybe had some possessive qualities today, because David walks away from his mother immolating herself. Like, you know, I thought he was traumatized earlier, and now suddenly he was personable. And I was like, just this kid's in reverse. and I think maybe that might've been an answer, but yeah, I didn't want to see Roger go after he was so fun to watch for so long. And, you know, I initially thought he was, I think you could see the menace between him and Vicky, because they first met on the hill. And there was definitely, I mean, he was charming and sweet in a way that you didn't expect him to be after Elizabeth had just told him, you're all the problems in Collinwood.
Right.
He was really charming and nice to Vicky. And then all that changes when she mentions this Burke Devlin she met on the train. And
sure. Yeah. Yes.
You could almost hear the piano key. Duh.
Yeah. Like, how dare you have coffee with Burke Devlin, you know? And then the pen, of course, too, when the pen comes into play, the pen that was found, you know, on the beach after Bill Malloy was killed. You know, there's the whole game with, you know, who has the pen and where's the pen. Yeah. And Roger gets it and buries it on the beach. And then he unburies it and they catch him in the act. And it's, I'm surprised they never released that pen as a, you know, merchandise, you know, a collectible. I'd get that pen.
It was like, it looked like it was made out of like smelted silver or something. It was like slag metal or something that was coated onto a pen almost. Interesting looking, right?
I mean, definitely. That pen became as like a sort of a prominent, character in and of itself in that storyline.
And I guess that maybe that's the way soap operas were back then, that they would sort of be super melodramatic about something that maybe it's not that special. You know, it's not like it's a haunted pen, or, you know, it's not like the key to some ancient, civilization of monsters underneath the house.
Sure. If that had storyline had taken place, you know, a year and a half later, then it certainly would have been that, because it turns from sort of a semi soap opera, semi thriller, like, you know, thriller suspense serial would hybridize with a soap opera, but then it kind of morphs into this really bizarre, you know, gothic horror, dark fantasy time travel show, which is great. It's just really bonkers when you watch the show over all the episodes in a row, which I've been watching Dark Shadows for years, but I rewatched it during the pandemic. And just as you're doing now, just watching it all the way through. And it's like, you see the sort of frenetic, crazy pace with which they're changing direction and adding new levels of bizarre storytelling and characters. You can see where Dan Curtis in these early episodes started to sort of push it in that direction. You know, when Matthew Morgan takes Vicky prisoner in the old house, and, you know, you see you had seen the ghost of Bill Malloy when David locked Vicky in the abandoned wing of Collinwood and left her there to her fate. And you see the ghost of Bill Malloy dripping with seaweed, singing, you know, what can you do with a drunken sailor? You start to see.
I keep thinking of London Bridge is Falling Down song. Yes.
They Sarah. Did. Yeah. Yeah.
Sarah, my current theory is that Vicky is the modern Sarah. You know, everybody else has a doppelganger, but I'm thinking Vicky might actually be adult Sarah in terms of there's no current Sarah anywhere else.
Sure. Yeah. Which is kind of creepy if you're considering Barnabas is, you know, a drawn to her.
but that's why I'm thinking, oh, of course he has no idea this is what, because clearly, like you said, Maggie is Josette. They decided to to really double down on, despite what they set up initially. Although, like you said, they brought up was it Harcombe, the other
Hanscombe,
Hanscombe. They brought they dangled that plot thread, never took it anywhere, and maybe there was going to be a connection there. But yeah, I in the back of my head, that's why we're not seeing anybody who looks like Sarah, because that's Vicky.
Like she's the reincarnation of Sarah, like in when she was a child, maybe she looked exactly like Sarah. That's an interesting theory. Yeah.
They even had the same hair color, at least in one of the colored episodes, you know, which is weird, because I thought of Vicky as having black hair, but then in a couple of shots it was looked red, but, or auburn, I guess. Yeah, I think that I'm sorry. I'm getting
Oh no, that's okay. We were talking about when Matthew Morgan has Vicky, he's holding Vicky prisoner, and the ghosts come out of everywhere in the old house. The ghosts of the widows, Josette's ghost, Bill Malloy's ghost, they all
to the rescues.
they all sort of converge there, and I mean, I think at that point, that's when it turns into a gothic horror show. It goes from a sort of a gothic romance thriller to gothic horror show, because the ghosts kill Bill Malloy, or they scare him to death. You know, and they find not Bill Malloy, Matthew Morgan rather. Yeah. They find Matthew Morgan. They say his face is, you know, contorted in horror. It's a really compelling, I think, scene to watch. And I think that's a pivotal scene in Dark Shadows, because you can see Dan Curtis's stamp all over that. It's like, let's have the ghosts kill this guy, you know? I think
you're rooting for it by then. Because he's terrorized Vicky.
Unhinged. He's completely unhinged. And it would have been interesting to see George Mitchell, the original Matthew Morgan. I don't know if he would have had the same, because Thayer David is so physically imposing. I wonder how George Mitchell would have played that role, because he seemed, you know, very irritable and you know, he had it's funny, he had that New England, you know, the main, you know, accent, the eye up, you know, I can't get there from here, you know, that kind of, and ironically, Thayer David is a New Englander, native New Englander. He's from Massachusetts, I believe. But George Mitchell had that real, you know, a very strong Maine accent that he was putting on. And I mean, I don't know. I would have been interested to see him play the unhinged version of Matthew Morgan, the Matthew Morgan who's completely snapped, you know.
I mean, well, like I said, how there's a lot of mundane mixed in with all this supernatural. And in that way, I think that Thayer probably had, he had something was a much more an otherworldly menace to him, even though he was not the smartest villain in the arsenal. He wasn't just grouchy like Mitchell was. He wasn't just a grumpy loner that I didn't think the other Mitchell. This is
George Mitchell. Yeah,
George Mitchell. I didn't think he was particularly threatening, obnoxious. Mm-hmm. Annoying, kind of a bore, you know. Those things, but I didn't think of him as somebody to be worried about. And maybe that actually did color why I didn't see Matthew as the problem later. Although I definitely knew the actor Thayer had played villains very well. He killed that duck in Sent Journey to the Center.
Yes,
never going to forgive him for that. you know.
Thayer David is, I love Thayer David. I think he ends up playing more characters in Dark Shadows than any other actor. Maybe he's tied with Nancy Barrett, or maybe she did one less than he did, or they might be tied, but Thayer David plays a variety of fascinating and strange characters throughout the run of the series. You're watching him as Ben right now, who's like the good guy version of Matthew Morgan, It's like Matthew Morgan with a heart, you know.
And his name is Stokes here. So I didn't realize they set up him being the ancestor of, or relative of Professor Stokes.
Yeah, he's his ancestor.
As opposed to Matthew. And that's kind of an interesting switch too, because if you're watching it, you're thinking this is the ancestor of Matthew, you know, the first character he played. And now it's not. It's setting up future characters. So that's
right. And his, you know, descendant, Ben's descendant, of course, is very, you know, highly educated, you know.
Yeah, the opposite of
expert on the occult, you know, so.
I'm going to make sure my children and progeny have some standards.
Yeah. And of course, Stokes will become he's sort of the ersatz Van Helsing of the show. I think I referred to him as, because he's the, in the sense that he's the occult expert. He's the character they go to when there's some, you know, mysterious symbol or exorcism that needs to be performed or something like that. So I love Professor Stokes and Ben too.
You can see the need for that when with some of the characters they've had up to now, they frequently get killed off, like Dr. Guthrie and
Dr. Woodward. Yeah.
I was kind of mixed on Woodward though, because they changed actors right at a crucial moment
for
it was almost like, so they killed him off because they couldn't keep the actor, right? I mean, you know, this new guy is making mistakes left and right.
Right. And I think I suspect they were going to kill him off at that point anyway. I mean, Robert Geringer was the original actor. He wouldn't, it was a strike, you know, and he wouldn't cross the picket line. So they had to hire another actor, but yeah, they got Peter Turgeon, who definitely very different portrayal of the character.
It was like going from Tony Randall to Fred Mertz. It was like, what?
Yeah. There's an interesting, I think it was the Collinsport Historical Society and their Dark Shadows Daybook did a write-up of sort of when Peter Turgeon takes over. And it was an interesting take on the character of Dr. Woodard, because at that point he's learned so much that he's now become paranoid and wearing this trench coat, and he knows more than any human should know about the other side, you know. So he's changed as a character, which is interesting, you know, outside of just, you know, the physical differences in the character, but his actual personality has gone through sort of an alteration because of the things that he's learned up to that point. So that, I thought that was an interesting take on that. But just getting back to that's okay. No, I love
going tangents. Down the stairwell, the magic stairwell through time here.
Yes, yeah, exactly. Yeah. not at all. Actually, the stairway through time is going to come up a little bit later, because there's something else I wanted to talk about. But I think the last character we haven't really touched on we didn't really talk a bunch about Joe, but you know, Joe Haskell, who I loved Joe when he, Maggie and I love the combination of Maggie and Joe. I did not like Carolyn and Joe as a couple at all. But I do love Maggie and Joe as a couple. They're just really sweet. I don't know. I really like them as a couple. And Joe, I don't want to spoil anything, but it's really sad to see what happens to their relationship due to the supernatural and outside factors in the series, where the show kind of shifts in that direction. And you do kind of lose when we, you know, later on, I think, especially when Barnabas shows up and he becomes the star of the show, you do kind of lose the sort of the moral compass, sort of starts spinning. There are no more, like, you know, the heroes of the show are all murderers at that point.
I mean, I think that's why they don't let them learn about Barnabas.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. They, you
know,
yeah.
I keep getting confused that they don't know. I keep forgetting, mm-hmm. especially in the time travel thing. I keep forgetting. Mm-hmm. That's right. Vicky doesn't know who he is. But they couldn't let them know, because then I thought initially he was going to avoid eating people. He was just going to kill cattle, but I guess they finally decided no. And people are being attacked in the street, you know, in the woods and stuff. And, so they can't know he's a vampire, because then
They're complicit
with what he's doing. And I think that's why, you know, I haven't gotten to the end of 1795, but you mentioned that they were setting up David to figure out what Barnabas is before that. And they just dropped that later. And I think it's because originally they were going to kill Barnabas off as the monster.
Oh yeah, they definitely were. After 13 weeks, that was the plan. Right. They were going to stake Barnabas. He was going to kill, Julia was going to die too. He was going to kill Julia. And originally Julia was a male character. And they, you know, and then they mistyped the name instead of Julian, they typed Julia, and Curtis saw that. He said, oh, let's make the doctor a woman. But they were going to kill her off too. She was going to kind of be the Van Helsing at first. and then they were going to kill her off, and Barnabas was going to get staked, and probably, you know, part of it was David being in danger at that point. And then they just sort of drop it. And my theory on that is we saw two instances in the show where Barnabas used his sort of hypnotic influence to mind wipe children. There were two instances, and it was Nora Collins in one instance, and the parallel time Daniel Collins, and he used his hypnotic gaze to sort of wipe their mind. So I'm my sort of, I guess, fan wank theory is what they call it, like off screen, Barnabas got David somehow. You know, maybe David was so riled up at that point, maybe Barnabas couldn't like access him, but maybe at that.
Yeah,
he did get access to David at some point and erased his memory or something.
I wish they could have worked that in, just because the connection between David and Barnabas was actually something that was very.
Yeah.
I mean, despite what a monster David was when we first met him. Mm-hmm. I wanted to kill that David.
I want to talk about him next, actually. Yeah.
But I thought that the connection between, I mean, David and Burke was one of the more touching connections in the show. And they even gave him a goodbye.
Oh, heartbreaking. That was heartbreaking.
Yeah. When he started talking the way, I was like, Burke about to die? You know?
Yeah.
And then I thought that the connection with Barnabas was one of the things, because they both loved the family history, and I just thought that was a very strong bond to have at the heart of the show, one of the hearts of the show. And then he's talking about killing David, and I felt like, hasn't it occurred to you that David's talking to your sister's ghost that you want so much to connect with? He could speak between you.
Sure.
Have you thought about maybe he'd keep the secret? Yeah. I mean, But like we're saying, if he knew, then that would mean poor David is aware of a murderer or at least, I mean, maybe they're not clear about, does seem to be leaving people alive when he attacks them. I guess maybe he's not killing everybody. I mean, he killed Woodward. I mean,
Barnabas's body count is going to add up quite a bit over the course of the series. Barnabas kills a lot of people.
Jason,
yeah.
Too, I forgot. I didn't mind him killing Jason.
Jason. Yeah. 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 My friend Erin was watching, and she had not, you know, watch the series before, and she kept texting me saying, please tell me that Barnabas kills Jason. I said, hang on. David, speaking of David, what a psychopath. I mean, Roger calls him an incipient psychopath at one point. And that's basically what getting with David Collins. You know, David is, he tries to murder his father by taking the bleeder valve out of his car. Then he tries to plant it on Burke. And then he realizes he actually likes Burke and he gets along with Burke. And then he feels some remorse for that. So at least we see some conscience there on David's part, but he doesn't. Then I think he tries to plant it on Vicky at one point.
He does. He's like Angelique. He's an absolute
at
the beginning.
He really is. Yeah. You know,
maybe that's where Angelique's been all this time. She was possessing David.
There you go. There we go.
And Angelique and Laura look a little alike.
I think they were going to do that in the 91 series of Angelique and Laura. I think we're going to be the same character, because the painting of Laura in the 91 series looked like Lizette Anthony as Angelique. And I think they were going to link the characters there. But anyway.
Well, they both like fire a lot, too.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
She uses fire like. As far as David, I'm not exactly sure when. I think he really started to change when Vicky finally saw a ghost.
Yes. Then she was cool.
He was like, oh, so they like you. So that makes me, you're okay. Now, why he would then forget he knew about ghosts when dealing with Sarah, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing there I could figure was that, well, after Laura was gone, or the Phoenix had gone, he changed. So maybe part of him and part of who he had been was this other David that was supposed to burn up. And what we're left now is this fairly innocent soul that hadn't anything to do with that.
I like that theory. That's a great theory, because that is where the character sort of, you know, he does start to change when he finds out Vicky saw a ghost, but he really changes after the incident with Laura. And maybe there is, maybe part of him did kind of burn up from the sort of metaphysical perspective, I guess, or paranormal perspective. I guess maybe that part of him kind of did go up in flames, you know, and what we were left with was the pure David, that the dark side of David evaporated with Laura. I like that theory. That's a great theory.
Yeah. trying to make sense but they did sometimes write themselves into a corner. Like remember, Roger hated, Guthrie. And didn't want anything to say, for example of hackery I've never heard in my life.
Yes.
And then they tell him, well, he's a parapsychologist. And then it was like, okay, he's already been in a 10. He has nowhere to go. So we go, well, maybe there's something to all this, you know.
Yes.
I don't know.
And then he's the one leading the seance at the old house during the costume party. You know, it's like, wait, Roger wants to have a seance. What's happening right now? Roger's the first one to scoff at the idea of a seance.
I don't have any answers for that one. Roger just had a different drink.
It's the sherry, too much sherry, the claret cup.
it's funny because they had given us the whole background on the whole backstory we knew already about what happened with the car crash with Sam and all that. And it was only when they resolved it was many episodes later, not to give us a new surprise, but to have Roger admit, okay, yes, I did it. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And at that point, Burke is like, you disgust me. I'm not going to go after you.
He's yeah, he's over it at that point. He just wanted to hear. I just wanted to hear you say it, you know. And
right.
But I think it's you know, his involvement with Vicky sort of tempered his desire for revenge. But it is kind of anticlimactic after all that time that's. Oh, okay. That's over.
They wanted to bury it at that point. They didn't. I mean, because it's sort of like not quite the same. It's sort of like with Barnabas. Their plan was for the guy to be killed off. And you can see they were writing towards that conclusion.
Yeah.
But then they didn't want that to be the end. So they had to change things. Mm-hmm. And that meant that the climax that you were headed for no longer. No longer pays off. I was going to say Julia is a character that they kind of had her tormenting, or not a real word. They had her anguished about what was going on in him wanting to hurt all these people. I was a little surprised that she was trying to protect Maggie. And well, initially she was her doctor, so she should be, but she was kind of villainous in a way, so I wasn't expecting her to continue protecting Maggie and Vicky and David all from Barnabas.
Yeah.
So it was like, I know I thought of her as a villain, but really she was a very she was a heroic character in that sense. Mm-hmm. And I guess the moral, you know, compass feeling a little off was that she was still letting him do a lot of bad stuff off screen that we were having an inkling of, and she was still kind of courting evil with this experiment that never quite made sense. I never quite understood how this was going to not end up aging him just like he thought it was going to, you know.
Right.
Old man. He's like, how old? Of course he's not going to. He's not super nice. She had confidence. That was her gift. She had they say, give me the confidence of a mediocre man. And she had that in spades, you know. She's like, I am perfectly fine, that, you know, convinced that this will work.
And right. Yeah.
I'm like, wow, you know?
Destined for disaster. Because I mean, yes. And any cure for Barnabas is never going to be it's always going to end badly. I think it's never, because it's a supernatural affliction. And it's actually George DiCenzo, who I've talked about the connection. We're talking about connecting. We both work on Masters of the Universe, the brand. George DiCenzo, who was the associate producer for Dan Curtis, he would sometimes write back to fans, their fan mail. And he explained how, you know, Barnabas's affliction is a supernatural affliction. So any cure for Barnabas's curse from a medical perspective is never going to last, you know, because it's a supernatural affliction, you know? So, and it's an interesting idea, and they do go there, and, you know, there might be temporary periods where the curse is, you know, halted or paused perhaps. And that comes from a House of Dracula. Yeah.
House of Dracula.
Yeah. Where they try to cure Dracula. Yeah. John Carradine as Dracula.
It was sort of also in Dracula's Daughter too, except I think there was psychoanalysis.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. George DeCenzo, as I was going to mention, he was the voice of Hordak in the She-Ra cartoon, but he was also the associate producer of Dark Shadow. He went into acting. He was, you know, even at that time, he wanted to act. The other connection I saw was with Masters of the Universe. This is a weird tangent, but Jonathan Frid starred in Oliver Stone's first film, Seizure, horror film, and his wife in the film was played by Christina Pickles, who was the sorceress in the 1987 He-Man movie. So there's the other connection there. I'm jumping all over the place, but something that...
Sorry, you're going to be editing this forever.
Oh, that's okay. No, it's my fault. I went there, but...
I'm sorry. I've been like taking us in tangents and stuff and out of order.
I love tangents. Those are great. One thing I want to bring up is in those pre-Barnabas episodes, we get some of the Collins family history. We hear about, you know, Benjamin Collins and Theodore Collins. Some of these portraits that hang in the drawing room are named, and we find out their names, at least. We never find out what their role was in the family history, really, but we hear about them. And of course we hear about Jeremiah Collins, who built Collinwood. Of course, you know, when we go to 1795, it seems that Joshua built well, I guess they both did, because Jeremiah seemed pretty actively involved when it was still being constructed. Yeah. But
Vicky, wasn't it?
And of course we also have Josette, who married Jeremiah, and the sense we get in these early episodes is that, you know, Jeremiah was older, middle age, and Josette threw herself from Widow's Hill in the 1830s, you know, and Jeremiah buried her, had her buried, not in the Collins, you know, family tomb, but, you know, away from it. And there are definitely some very different story elements that were later retconned. And of course, you know, the writers were kind of retconning and making things up a lot of the time as they went along. And then that's the real life explanation. But I'm curious, maybe some thoughts about why, from an in-canon perspective. I love this kind of stuff where you speculate on how this works in the storyline. And I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, Eric, or if you've kind of come up with any ideas for that.
Well, I definitely got the feeling when we went back in time to 1795, things are definitely different than I thought they'd be. Mm-hmm. I had always been under the impression that Barnabas was much younger when Sarah was alive. Mm-hmm. Probably adding to that, you know, that Vicky reincarnation idea, even though her ghost admittedly is around, is just like Josette's ghost is around, and yet we seem to have the idea of a bodily reincarnation as well. Mm-hmm. But I think for the 1830 date, I don't know. I had the same thought too, that it was all happening much later than the 1700s. Mm-hmm. I'm not, it's possible there is some historical, you know, like the history that's far enough back that maybe some inaccuracies have made it to the modern time. So they're getting their dates wrong. Mm-hmm. I assume I have not reached the end of the 1795. So I'm not quite sure where we leave some of these characters, what meddling, is possible to have been done by, people that, you know, some of the forces that are, you know, existing in this past, you know, maybe they started covering their tracks a bit. I guess it's entirely possible that Josette could live until 1833 and then commit suicide. I don't think that's going to happen, because I'm pretty sure they're going to do it all in this little arc here. But I suppose if like I said, a lot of it feels different when it's abstract. Once they're actually characters in front of us, all of a sudden things start to change a bit, and you have new considerations that, you know, you can't spent, you know, say their story can't end 30 years later, you know, I mean, sure. Even though that might make sense on paper, it doesn't make sense if you're, so I guess my biggest, that being my big cop out with the date in accuracy, is to say that they were not getting all of their facts correct.
I think that's part of it. I think part of it is that, that they weren't, like Joshua, some of them were intentionally putting in incorrect information into the Collins family history to cover up things that happened that they don't want anybody to find out about. Oh. So they couldn't have conceivably just made up,
well,
you know, happy endings for these characters in the Collins family history.
They covered up Angelique, didn't they? I mean,
yeah.
Because she's like, you're married to Barnabas? What? No. Why is that surprising to you? No reason. No reason at all. I'm not a time traveler.
Yeah, exactly. You start right away. You start. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. There are things are different. Vicky right away sees, wait, that's not what I was told. You know, so there are, we see that there are already things that are, that have been altered intentionally. Then I think there is also
being there is altering stuff. I'm sure.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because Barnabas, I'm like, there's no way he doesn't know that this is somebody he should know. You know, if he'd met her as much as, you know, for her to be involved with such crucial events in his life.
Right.
He wouldn't, he would be going, you're Vicky Winters, Victoria Winters, who I know. He wouldn't be saying you're Josette's returned, you know.
Anything. Sure. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. I think there's clearly some historical, perfunctory, hackery, is that the word?
Yeah, hackery.
I got that word at least twice, I think, for Roger. Roger and Joshua got to say it, I think.
Yes.
Or no, Barnabas, maybe.
Barnabas, right. And then we also have, okay, so I've mentioned this, you know, when we were talking a little bit over email, but in Dark Shadows, there is so much time travel centered around Collinwood, not only with Vicky in this storyline, but then you have astral time travel with the I Ching, and you have the Quentin building this alchemical stairway through time. You know, Quentin is the first Quentin, the great uncle of the Quentin that everybody likes, you know, or, you know, there's an older, they're older version of Quentin, I guess his granduncle builds this staircase through time, metaphysical experiment, he calls it. And he's obsessed with the occult, and he builds this stairway through time. And I think the combination of the stairway through time and all the time travel that's happening then tears open a warp into a parallel universe or multiple parallel universes, because they start exploring the parallel time bands as well in the show, which is crazy for
what started as,
yeah,
my name is,
right,
Victoria Winters. I'm just coming to look for my parents. You know,
right. Yeah. Let's go into a parallel time band and do Jekyll and Hyde over there and Rebecca. So you have all this, you know, tinkering with time and tearing open gateways into other dimensions and into other time periods. I think time is starting to sort of collapse on itself in Collinsport. You know, Collinsport is such an isolated little town,
yes,
away from everything else. And I think, you know, Buffy the Vampire Slayer, they call Sunnydale a hellmouth. I think Collinsport is kind of like that too, but it's also there's a lot of timey-wimey stuff happening in Collinsport, yeah, where dates are just changing, you know, nothing is consistent. It's fluid. Everything is very fluid. The dates on gravestones change sometimes, and it does in the show too, because you'll see the date Josette dies is different in the Collins family history. It's different when you see it on screen. It's different when you see it on the gravestone. Same for Ben. You know, there's a lot of time travel in the show, and you know, things are, there are parallel time bands as well. Some people like to explain it as every storyline is actually set in a different time band. I'm not sure how I feel about that, because I like the idea of we're still watching the same characters that we started out with. I don't like the idea of like, oh, these are other characters in a different time band that we're watching now.
Oh, I like that. Explain why characters change, like David from Laura to post Laura and stuff.
Yeah,
like
you
that.
Could. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that is a valid sort of position to take, but I like the idea that it's sort of something a little more bizarre is happening. And I wish they had done sort of a time crisis storyline in the show where, you know, they have to address the fact that they've punctured holes in the time stream. You know, you're actually messing things up and changing history and creating multiple time bands. And I like the idea that, yeah, I would have liked it if they had it actually addressed that, like something really bad is happening here because of all the time travel that's been taking place in Collinwood, you know?
I haven't obviously gotten to like the Leviathans. I know of them, but I know there's a lot of elder god sort of things ahead that might be the kind of Hellmouth sort of dimension talk. Mm-hmm. And
the one thing I did like about the 2004 series, mm-hmm. the unaired pilot. They established the idea that, because cell phones existed already at that point, mm-hmm. but Collinsport, there's no cell service in Collinsport. Like you can't use your cell phone in Collinsport. I said, yes, exactly. Exactly. You shouldn't even, if they're going to mention cell phones, they don't, at least they don't work in Collinsport, which is the right thing.
Yeah.
That is the right choice. Like, no, of course there's no cell service in Collinsport.
I don't know if modern audio, because this was 2004. So cell phones were new. I don't know if a modern audience, well, they watch stuff like Shadows and Bone and all that stuff, mm-hmm. Where they don't have cell phones. So I don't, maybe they'll accept it, but mm-hmm.
I think they could. I think they would accept that self service doesn't work there. If they don't use a throwaway line in the first episode. Those don't work here. You don't bother.
Although 67 has an aesthetic to it that is mm-hmm. kind of unique. But then again, part of that was it was in black and white, which I did miss when we went.
Yes. Yeah. We didn't even talk about that. Yeah. I like that too. It has it has much more of a, 1930s, 1940s movie vibe. Like yeah.
In the pilot where when Vicky's on the train and when she has to get off the train, I felt like it was a Twilight Zone episode because we were seeing all these temporary sets that were convincing in a black and white production. Mm-hmm. But that kind of were keeping you in this otherworldly state. It wasn't bound to the same sound stages that later episodes would be. Not that I'm against it, but it is frustrating. We're always in that, especially in the 1795. I'm like, can we please go to the new house?
Because they're at the old house all the time. Yeah.
But yeah, that was another thing I thought was weird. I did not think the new house knew Collinwood was as old as 1795. I was a little surprised mm-hmm. by that. I thought that it was an 1800s. I've been to the Biltmore in North Carolina, and which is a fantastic house. Just like you wouldn't have. I mean, like it's like if you want to find a Collinsport or Collinwood, that place mm-hmm. doesn't have the same turrets that. Yeah. I can't remember the name of the real house.
Oh, it's the Carey Mansion, AKA the Seaview Terrace. Yeah.
Yeah. Seaview. It doesn't have that silhouette, but it is a mm-hmm. very atmospheric house. And the family, the Vanderbilts that built it, it's actually not just the house, it's the whole grounds. They like grew up the trees and everything that the old man that, Vanderbilt passed away before. He never got to see those trees grow up and create the atmosphere the place has now.
But
the family lived in this little wing in the back of the house. I think it was either the servants' quarter, former servants' quarters, or over the. It was like an apartment, and that they were living in there. They were probably still living there as of the late 1960s.
Okay. So
in my mind, that's sort of Collinwood, and if Collinwood were here today, it would not be. They wouldn't be living in it. It would be a house where they would have tourists coming to it, mm-hmm. which is why I'm like, I might want to keep 1967 as a setting.
Right, right.
Because well, the houses,
yeah. The family who owns the Carey Mansion, they do live there still. They rented for a while. They rented part of it out to Salve Regina as a dormitory, but they don't anymore. And they live in part of the house, but it's definitely in need of repair. I mean, it's such a big place, and I don't know if they're there year round or not. But I know they are there at least part of the year, and they should. I think they really. I wish they would use that for conventions. There's sometimes they'll do like a Halloween event where they'll do, Yeah. Sometimes they'll do a small Halloween event where like fans will, you know, spend the night at Collinwood, but they could really do something pretty big with that, because the conventions, which I didn't even talk about in the last episode, I didn't get into the sort of the modern era of Dark Shadows fandom, where with the internet, there are some great websites out there like the Dark Shadows forums, and also the Classic Horror Film Board, which has a forum for television horror. And there's the active discussion there on Dark Shadows, and the Dark Shadows forums I've been a member of for quite a long time. But there also have, sadly, not in the last few years, but every year there were Dark Shadows festivals, which were conventions that were, they would alternate between the West Coast and the East Coast for the Dark Shadows festivals between New York and Los Angeles. And I've been twice to the Dark Shadows festivals. And I tried to go to the 50th anniversary one, and it was sold out. I couldn't get in. And I wish they would update it, because the way they used to do the festivals, even up until that time, until late 2016, it was for the 50th anniversary, you would have to send a self-addressed stamped envelope to get to the convention. And then they would send you the tickets in the mail. I wish they, but then they stopped after the 50th anniversary, and the two I went to, I had a blast. I really, really enjoyed going, and I wish they would do them again. And if they bring it back, it would be awesome if they actually did it at Collinwood, you know, like at, like if they actually held the convention at Collinwood. They do some events at the Lyndhurst Mansion in Tarrytown, where they shot the movies, The House and Night of Dark Shadows at Tarrytown, at the Gould Estate in Tarrytown. But it would be cool to have it at like the house from the TV show, I think. Yeah.
I don't know if it might be, parking might be their problem. Cause I know
with
the Biltmore, they've got, you park down by the Vineyard they have like resorts there, and mm-hmm. you get a bus up to the house. Mm-hmm. And so that, you know, and you would probably have a harder time. I don't know what, I mean, the pictures I've seen of the Curry Mansion, it looks more like it's actually surrounded by some other neighbors.
Yeah. Parking would be a challenge there. Yeah. Now that you mentioned that. Yeah.
But I don't disagree. That would be a wonderful, I mean, I don't know. It's such a big house and has that history. I'm surprised they wouldn't have tourist interest in it, but mm-hmm.
They've done some, like, I know some of those ghost hunter shows have done episodes there and stuff, you know, where they do the ghost investigations and stuff.
We have to do a ghost hunter show now.
There we go.
We're hunting for the ghost of Sarah.
Maybe we'll find the ghost of Josette and ask her why her last name is Dupre when we meet her. But in the early episodes, they said her last name is Lefreniere. It's like that. There's another plot inconsistency. I'm like, they changed her last name. My theory on that is Lefreniere is her middle name.
Or her mother's maiden name, maybe, or something.
Ooh, there we go. There we go. I like that. Anyway, all right. Well, we're going to end things off here. Thank you so much for joining me.
I'm sorry I've kept you going so long.
Oh, no, not at all. It was wonderful talking with you. And thank you. I know you don't often do podcast appearances, so I'm honored that you would come onto my new podcast to talk about Dark Shadows. Usually we've talked about He-Man stuff because we worked on it for so long at this point, but it's nice to talk Dark Shadows with you.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I'm glad to talk with, to talk about a show I'm just really, really seriously looking at. I mean, like I said, I'd seen it before, but I'd never really gotten from, it's a different experience when you see it from the beginning it's not the same as, I suppose, watching it and it's a completed total story planned from the very start. No, obviously you have to accept that there are going to be changes and some setups that decide that they change their minds about and they don't use. Mm-hmm. That's probably easier to accept when you're watching an older show versus one that's being made for you now.
Right. And I think that's part of the joy of watching it is that sort of frenetic pace at which they're creating the show. It is creating a new little play every day that they're putting on tape and broadcasting, but they're writing, rehearsing and recording this like little mini play and building these little sets and it's kind of awesome that they were able to actually accomplish that. And that's something, and I think that's a big reason you're never really going to be able to recreate Dark Shadows or redo Dark Shadows, because it was definitely a lightning in a bottle situation, and it hit during the monster craze too, in the late 60s, early 70s. You know, things like Famous Monsters of Filmland were at the height of their popularity in the shock theater package on television, with the horror host showing the movies. And you had, that was in the air at the time, right? And Dark Shadows came just right at the right time, I think. I don't know if they were to do it now, how it would play. I think a lot of creators are afraid to sort of embrace the gothic characteristics of storytelling. I think there's a desire to go for, we have to show some gore, you know, we have to go for the gore, and you don't have to do that much of the gore. I think you maybe see a hint of it, you know, a splash of blood. I don't think you need to go all the way with it. The one filmmaker I think who could do it, if he held back on sort of the more gruesome stuff, is Guillermo del Toro. I think Guillermo del Toro gets it. He gets what, because he loves that stuff. He grew up reading those gothic novels and loving those films. And I think Guillermo del Toro could do Dark Shadows, but it wouldn't be that same feeling of that sort of frenetic, let's put a live play on horror play on TV every day. But I think he could capture the feel of that sort of isolated house on a hill with the waves crashing on the rocks, and these sort of brooding characters who are all have secrets. And I think he would get that aspect of it.
Yeah, I think part of my difficulty is it's not just the literary, but also the cinematic history of Gothic that that I feel is, it's hard to separate it from black and white. And it's hard to really, I think, attract a modern audience to it because it feels passé. Yeah. I felt like when I the 2004 pilot, when I watched, I was seeing a lot of David Lynch, and I'm like, oh, well, I suppose, Blue Velvet, Twin Peaks, I guess those things, they do kind of feel like modern versions of the similar kind of the what's really going on beneath the happy town. But and people don't think so much perhaps of you know, Hitchcock's Rebecca or Wuthering Heights, you know, with Orson Welles, you know, or any of those sorts of things. Or did he was in that, wasn't there? Am I getting that mixed?
I'm sorry, what? Orson Welles was in, Jane Eyre.
Was, oh, okay, it was.
Wuthering Heights was Olivier, I think.
Was that Olivier?
I think it was Olivier.
Heathcliff out on the, oh, I remember. It was, he said that, Macbeth, he said it was the perfect combination of Bride of Frankenstein and Wuthering Heights.
And I think, I don't know. I don't know if modern audiences they do though. I mean, I don't know. The Penny Dreadful series, you know, that was pretty popular, but they also went too much for the gore. I think they showed too much. I think you can't, you have to pull back a little bit. Why I say Guillermo del Toro is when he kind of does his own thing, not the big Hollywood movies, but sort of things like Crimson Peak or The Orphanage.
Yeah, I need to rewatch that one recently. I did see that one, but I remember not being aware there were classes of ghosts, the red ghost versus the black ghost, the white ghost. And
then he did The Orphanage, which earlier on, which I thought was quite good. I think he would get the feel right for it, as opposed to somebody like Tim Burton, who they ultimately went with, who claimed he was a big fan when he was growing up, but he went for that tongue-in-cheek sort of take on things. And I don't want to get into the Burton movie, but it's another kettle of fish from the cannery. But
I think the thing there is that you don't just have the director's vision for something like a property like this. You probably have to deal with a lot of producers and interest in it, then they're probably going to push it in commercial directions.
And I think you're right there.
They probably said, you know, this is going to be more successful if it's funny.
Yeah.
You know, Johnny Depp has played lots of funny characters. He was, you know, his, I mean, even Sleepy Hollow, he was sort of funny in that, even though it was a very scary, had very scary, intense moments, that he was a kind of a joke within it. And Jack Sparrow, big humorous character, or right. his Michael Jackson, Willy Wonka. Mm-hmm. So I forget if that was before. That was before Dark Shadows.
It was before.
And so they probably said, that's our commercial bet there. And somebody like Del Toro would probably be allowed to go in that other tone. But I also am not sure if they're very good at marketing that, because mm-hmm. Crimson Peak, I don't think, did really well.
No, I don't think so. I don't think Warner Brothers would get it.
I love Bram Stoker's Dracula with Gary Oldman, mm-hmm. and yet that's as artistic as that film is. I remember it was a big deal when it came out. I remember it was in all the magazines, and it was just. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That's the last. I mean, I know they did Dracula 2000, but that's the last time I remember Dracula really being a mm-hmm. big cultural deal. I mean, that Dracula Untold thing kind of came and went, or God help us, that Van Helsing movie.
What a letdown that was. Oh. I was hoping for so much. So many of us were with Van Helsing. It's like, whoa, that's great. They're making a movie about Van Helsing. What an awesome idea, And
Gabriel Van Helsing. What?
Yeah.
I think the part where the widow, the two brides are crying upside down, and he's yelling at them, can't you get your act together? Have you no heart? No, I don't. And he sounded like the Count, and I was like, you can't be serious. This is so cute. This is.
I'm having flashbacks.
I know. There was so much potential to. I mean, I should have known, because. Stephen Sommers tends to be kind of I liked The Mummy and The Mummy Returns, but not in a way that said this is like my new religion. It was they were pulpy, stupid, and
they were pulpy action movies. That's kind of what they were, but
I didn't realize how much Peter Jackson's King Kong was originally going to be almost exactly like that.
And was it? I didn't know that.
That was his original plan. Was it was going to be, in fact, I think it was going to start with and Darrow happened to be an assistant to somebody in archaeology in Egypt or something, and mm-hmm. they were going to find their map to the island there or something. I mean, mm-hmm. it was very different, and you can almost see it when I rewatched it. I don't know, a month ago or something. I can't tell time anymore. But I rewatched it sometime recently and was like, oh, I see how that would have been the adventure tone they were going for. And that's why this feels the way it does on the ship, and how that was really what they had wanted. And they tried to make it a lot more serious once mm-hmm. that film had, because the Summers movie had come out and beat them to the punch, and they felt like, oh my God, did they steal our script or something? So they reimagined it all.
I see. Okay.
So that's just a peculiar thing. Sorry. That's another tangent.
Oh no, that's okay. Anyway. Okay. Well, let's wrap it up. Everyone, thank you so much for listening to this episode of Terror at Collinwood. Feel free to reach out to me. Send me an email with your thoughts on the pre-Barnabas episodes. I'm curious to hear your thoughts. Don't be shy. Send me an email at terror@collinwood@gmail.com. I've gotten a few emails already from our first episode, and some posts on social media, on Facebook, and on some of the message boards as well. So definitely drop me a line. I have struggled with the RSS feed for the podcast and finally figured out, I think, how to get it on Apple Podcasts. So it should be on Apple Podcasts, although the autofill feature doesn't seem to fill in the name of the podcast when I'm typing it out. But if you type in Terror at Collinwood and hit the search button on your Apple Podcast app, it will come up. The first episode is on there right now. By the time you're listening to this one, hopefully it will be on there as well. We're on Podbean. We're on all over the place. Listen Notes, all of Spotify, Stitcher, all of your podcast apps. We should be on there. So give us a listen on your favorite podcast app. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, make sure to rate us and leave us a comment. I think you're supposed to say that. That's what I hear. I don't know why, but that's what they say to do. So if you feel like doing it, go ahead and do it. If not, that's okay. And thank you so much for listening. And oh gosh, I need a better closing for this show, Eric. I haven't thought of a good closing for the show. Dark Shadows is a Dan Curtis production.
Yes. When it starts saying that, I always think it's going to say Dark Shadows is a damn fine production.
Yeah.